This is a video to show how to work with the Wollensak 5710 monophonic tape recorder. The reason is that the functions are not entirely intuitive. I want to go over the entire machine with you to show you exactly how each function works so you fully understand it. Now, when you get the machine and unpack it, it'll look like this, and you'll get that and this special power cord that I'm packaging with it. This is not the original power cord for the machine. The original power cord was lost, as was the head cleanout cover that goes over here. The loss of the head cleanout cover or the power cord does not in any way bother the function of the machine. This is a computer cord for, I'll bring it close, for laptop type computers that use what's called a Mickey Mouse plug, because when you look at it upside down, it's sort of like Mickey Mouse with his ears. Which I've specially modified by slitting it here and here so that it can fit in the socket in the back, and I'll show you how that works. The machine has a handle here which is extendable, so you pull it out. It's very stiff, and you can carry the machine like this. Now the thing is upside down when you carry it by the handle, as you can see here. And although you could work it upside down, it's kind of confusing. So the way the machine works is you turn it over. And it sits on the table like that. And this is the normal operation of the machine. Now let's take a look at the back and the power cord first. In the back here you see there is a piece here which was originally designed. This case is for both stereo and mono machines, so this was the other channel side of the input-output jacks, and they just simply blocked it off because there are no jacks there. This is the grill for the motor vent. This is the vent for the amplifier. And here you have your input and output jacks. You have a input for radio or line input. Here you have your preamp output, and that's for recording from the tape recorder. And here you have a speaker output. This is full powered. This is preamp, so it's low power. And obviously this is a line input jack. This red button here is for the circuit breaker, and this is the socket for the power cord. So to put the power cord in, you simply align it and push it straight in. Now obviously, because this power cord sticks out so much and is not at a right angle the way the original power cords were made, you can't run the machine on its back. I'll show you why. As you can see, the feet are shorter than the length of the power cord that's sticking out of the back. You have a power on-off switch here, which is a push button. When it is powered on, it will glow orange. When it is powered off, obviously it won't glow at all. This is your speed selector dial, and it has four speeds, 7.5, 3.75, 1 7/8, and a secret hidden speed of 15/16. These machines were originally designed to be four-speed machines. In the late 60s, they took away the fourth speed, but the mechanics were able to provide it, so I simply reset it so you could have the 15/16 if you were to need it. Obviously, this is your take-up table. This lever here is your pause lever, which is a manual pause lever, and it is not locking, so you'll have to hold it down when you're using it. Here is a small little button, which is your record interlock. This interacts with the record button here. This is your play or start button. It will engage the mechanism in both record and playback. This is your stop button. This will stop the functions from when it is in start or in record. This is the fast forward and rewind lever. This is your volume control. This is your tone control. This is a speaker on off switch, which will control whether or not The internal speaker, which is located on this side of the machine, is active. It also works for the external speaker. And this is your meter for checking your levels. On this side here, we have the four-digit tape counter with a push-button reset, your microphone input. This is the tape sensor switch, which is required for the automatic shutoff, and this is the feed table. On this side, we see the speaker for the unit. It is one speaker. There is a grill here. These screws are what mount the speaker to the machine. Originally, they had glued the speaker in. That caused the original speaker to warp. So when I put in the replacement speaker, I used bolts to hold it in place the way they normally are mounted in other tape recorders. And this will prevent warping. On this side, it looks like there's a second speaker, but actually this is just simply an empty grill, and it acts as a bass reflex port. So you will hear sound coming from here, but it is not through the speaker. It's through the backside of the speaker mounted on the other side. There is a defect here in this grill. There are some cracks from going about approximately here all the way up to the top. They could not be re-glued because any pressure on them would re-break them. So you just have to be careful not to push in on here when you hold the machine. The grills will hold itself together perfectly well because the plastic case is actually locked in by this silver overlap from the front faceplate. So just be aware that you want to be very careful about pushing in on this. It's old plastic, and that's why it cracked. Activate the machine. You press this button here with your thumb, and it will turn orange. At that point, you should hear the motor come on, but there is a second trick to working the motor. As you can see here, this is the tape sensor switch. It consists of this slot, and there is a black pin that rides up and down in the slot. If the pin is up inside the slot, it cuts off power to the motor, but not to the amplifier. To get the motor to come on, you simply lower the pin down, and then it will lock in the lower position because of a little spring, and you will hear the motor come on. By pushing gently on it, and if there's tape there, it will not go up into the slot. And of course, every time it goes on and off, you'll hear a snap through the audio part of this tape recorder. At this point, the tape recorder is actually turning, as you can see the capstan, which is located here, rotating. This is at 7.5 inches per second. Now here you see the speed selector switch. Because of the angle of the camera, you can't see the numbers, but it is registering 7.5 inches per second. This should only be rotated when the power is on and the capstan is spinning. To change speed, you simply dial. So you dial this way or you dial this way. This way increases speed, this way reduces. So we'll go down to 3.75. We're now at 3.75. There's a detent in the dial for every speed that you're going to. So we're now at 3.75. You can't see it, but it's actually there. Now we're at 1.875. And then we will go to the slowest speed, which is 15/16. Because this was not printed 15/16 on here, it is the hidden speed in case you were to need it, because some old tape recorders did record at 15/16, so I provided that speed for you, even though you may not need it. To go back up, you simply push this way till you feel a dent, and when it goes into the dent, it's locked in. Do it again, it's locked in, and do it for the last time, and it's locked in at 7.5 inches per second. Remember, always change speeds with the power on and the capstan turning. If you try to change speeds without the power on or without the capstan turning, you could put a dent in the idler, because it's a drive idler, like a record player drive idler, and it'll jam on the motor. So this has to be turned on, this has to be spinning. Although you probably will not want to make a recording, if you did, this is the key for doing that. there is an interlock here that I'm pressing with my thumb. To make a recording, you would push in the interlock and hold it. Then you push in the record button. Hold the record button in and release the interlock like I just did with my thumb. Then release the button and you see it staying in. If you push the interlock again, the record button will snap out. So you push the interlock in, push the record, hold the record, let go of the interlock. It is now ready to record if there were a tape in the machine. The control here for the digital counter is just a simple push button. So it's a four-digit counter, you just simply press the button to reset it. And obviously this is your microphone input. For rewind and fast forward, you use this lever, and it's a little bit wiggly, and they always made them like that to allow some play in the mechanism so it could reset itself. So you just allow for the wiggleness, that's just part of the way the machine was designed. So to go to fast forward, you do that. Now there, you cannot stop it with the stop button, you have to put it back into neutral, and then rewind, and then neutral. You can go from play, or start, or record, with the pinch roll and the capstan engaged and so on, directly into fast forward, or directly into rewind. It will automatically disengage the mechanism. You can see here the spinning capstan and the pinch roller, and here is the record playhead with the erase head built in, and underneath it are two little pressure pads that are red for the erase section and for the record play section, and they are on plungers. There is also in here a cam tire. It's called a power cam, and that's what makes the mechanism work, because everything here is controlled by springs. These are feather touch controls, that's what Wollensak calls them. So when I put it into start, you notice that the cam turned, allowing the mechanism to come forward. Now the pinch roller is engaged with the capstan, and you can see the two plungers here that are holding the pressure pads, which would hold the tape against the head. At this point, you can use your pause control. And the pause control will just simply lift the mechanism slightly. So, start, stop. Start, stop. Now, if I put it into fast forward, you see it automatically stopped. You can only stop fast forward with the lever. You cannot use the start button, the stop button. Each of these reels has two sections on the stem. There's the silver section and then the brownish, grayish section. This is a locking system, so as you can see that I can turn this upper part, and if I turn the lower part, the table goes. So that's how the reels get locked down. You pull them out, twist, and let them go to lock the reels. This is very common on some machines. So obviously you put the reel, the feed reel on here, and just align the pins. If you have problems, just keep spinning it until you're able to push it all the way through. Now lift this out, turn it a little bit, and let it go, and it'll lock the reel down. Do the same thing on the other side. The threading has to go through this slot correctly, which is a little bit difficult to do the way they designed it. So what I do is I thread the reels together by passing underneath, and then I take the tape and push it in. So let me do that now. At this point, the tape is running down below, which is not where it belongs. So what I need to do is push the tape up here so it's going into this area here between the for the tape output switch. Then it has to go into this little area here, which is metal, and there's a pointy piece and a flat piece that goes between the point and the flat, and that is the guide. There's a second one here. It obviously will pass over the pressure pads. Then it goes between the capstan and pinch roller, and there is another pin here, which you can just barely see, and it goes over that pin and then on through. So let me thread that now. All I do is I take this and just simply slide it in. Then I tighten up my tape by hand, and we're ready to go. So you can see how the tape is going between the pin and the slot, and then between the flat metal and the point, between the flat metal and the point, between the capstan and pinch roller, and straight on out to the take-up reel. Now, this is a stereo tape, so I've turned down the sound because this will only play a mono tape. And I press forward, and there it goes. Now, if I want to pause, I can just hold this button down, and it's in pause. When I release, it will go back. To stop, I just press the stop. Now, I forgot to release this pin, which means that at the end of the tape, it would continue to spin. If I just simply push the pin up, it is now trapped between the tape and the slot, so we cannot shut the machine off. It also provides a little bit of back tension for the reel. If I want to go to fast forward, I just simply could go that way. But I can't hit stop. I have to do it this way. If I want to rewind, I can do it this way. And you notice that on a full reel of 7-inch tape, it's a little bit sluggish. I allow the machine to be gentle because of the old tapes that you may be using. So as a consequence, I did not replace the rubbers. I did resurface the rubbers, but they are 50-year-old rubber, so they don't have the same grip that they had when the machine was new. But this works to your advantage because it's too gentle to rip up the tape. So to completely rewind, you just simply put in rewind and let it go. You will find that when you're using the little 3-inch reels, it's much faster because there's much less work. This is an 1800-foot reel of tape. And you notice that because of the tape cutout switch, as soon as the tape got free, the finger went up into the slot and the thing shut off. But you do have to still disengage. Now I'll show you a 3-inch reel. I have a 3-inch reel that I took off a portable tape recorder that actually made this recording. And I didn't want to rewind the tape and then re-thread it and so on. But you know, you can take these spools off and do whatever you want with them. So here we have them. As long as we keep the tape oriented correctly, it's not a problem. So I just simply load up the reels. It's easier because you don't have to thread. Lock the reels in place. Now I put the machine back into activation on that switch. And then I just slide in the tape, tension it, and you can see now that the tape is ready to go. Obviously, we're going too fast, so we just simply turn the speed down one notch, 3 3/4.
Activities are starting off with an open house or back to school night this evening from 7 to 9:30 at the Junction City Senior High School. All school patrons are invited, parents are...
Now, when you turn it off, you'll hear a little bit of a blurp. And the reason why is because when you push the stop button, this actually comes forward and then goes down. This is the way this thing was designed, so it always makes that silly noise when you push it into stop.
I certainly urge
Watch this
to
move.
Be present. This will be...
Did you see it go up?
An opportunity to...
And so at times you'll hear a blip when it stops. The volume control here is very, very sensitive. Wollensak 5700 machines were notorious for loud amplifiers. So you really only have to turn it up to 2 or 3, and you can watch your meter to get the proper optimal reading. As long as the white part of the meter is between the red and the black zones, just like any meter, you're in good shape.
Talk with the teachers. The Erie County Commissioners did not meet today due
to see it
the
fluctuating.
Veterans Day holiday. They will be meeting tomorrow. The Junction City Commission will be meeting tomorrow in regular session, and among items on their agenda, they will hear...
You can hear it's quite loud.
Sidewalk construction from
this
the city engineer.
This is your tone control.
The sidewalk installation project will encompass about 7.5 miles of sidewalks for the northwest section of the city. Otherwise, we can expect a continued partly cloudy.
When I push this, obviously the meter keeps registering, but the sound is gone.
Tonight and highs tomorrow again forecast for near 4. Currently, it's 38 degrees.
Washington is the scene of a discussion today between President-elect Richard Nixon and President Lyndon Johnson. Discussions center around peace in Vietnam. Israel, meanwhile, has accused the United Arab Republic of deliberately squandering chances to make progress toward peace in New York negotiations. The UN General Assembly is holding its annual discussion of whether to seat Red China. The answer is expected to be no. And the man-to-the-moon race between the U.S. and Russia may be getting closer.
So that's basically how you operate the machine.